is from Mark chapter 16. Now when the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there's the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. The Gospel of the Lord. Dear hearers of the Word of God, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our risen Lord and living Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. What do you do following a death? Well, on the one hand, there's nothing to do. Nobody goes to work, nobody goes to school, nobody feels like eating, nobody has anything to say. On the other hand, there is much to do. Family members need to be called. Funeral homes need to be contacted. Legal matters attended to. Travel arrangements made. Songs picked out. When are we going to have the funeral? What's the weather going to be like? Who knows? None of these basics of life and death have changed since the very beginning. Maybe some of the arrangements have, but it is said that the death rate has stayed the same since the beginning. One per person. Fortunately for the family and friends of Jesus, a nearby tomb has been provided by Joseph of Arimathea. He borrowed it. He had one. Pretty wealthy guy. Tombs back then were hewn, carved out of the rock. They were carved open large enough. Here's a picture of Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea. Nicodemus is one of the earliest converts to Christianity. He talked to Jesus back in John chapter 3, 16. And he wanted to know, what's this born again stuff all about? Well, he shows up in the end to help bury Jesus. Here's a picture of a tomb. The opening was about just wide enough so you could crawl through it on your hands and knees. And there's that heavy stone. Now, how many of you have picked rock in a field on a farm before? I'm just kind of curious. Okay. How do you suppose you could have picked up a rock like that? I'd like to see you do it. Even a small one about this is very heavy. People don't realize how heavy rocks are, stones are, and this one is very large. They would dig a trench, a half circle in front of the entrance. So when that stone rolled, gravity would take over and it would fall right in that little trench, and it's not going anywhere. Mark doesn't indicate at the end of the Gospel of Mark, and that's the Gospel we're reading to this year. Following, none of the Gospels indicate that he was anointed with spices prior to burial. The Sabbath, it was Friday night, it was getting dark, you're not supposed to work on the Sabbath, so they had to wait. Normally, man would put the spices on the dead body, the body would be stripped naked, and you do that, so men would anoint men, women would anoint women. Well, after he was dead, the men took off and scattered. They were gone. The women and looked on from a distance, watching, you know, the crucifixion. But the men were gone. Well, it's after the Sabbath. It's early Sunday morning now. The women are like, well, somebody's got to anoint the body. Somebody's got to do it. It needs to be done. It's when it's done. So Mark tells us. There's three of them. Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome. They brought spices. One last thing they can do for the one they followed and served. The Bible says they served him too and helped the disciples. One last thing, one final thing, an act of love, of devotion. But the question in their minds is a very good one. Who is going to move that stone? How are you going to do it? They saw it, you know, roll down there with a thud. Who does that? How are they going to do it? Who will roll the stone away from us? Well, when they get there, they find out that has already been taken care of. And they see a young man seated. An illustration here. A young man in white seated in the right. And as would be expected in the Bible, whenever a messenger of God shows up, people are scared. They're terrified. Just a month or a couple months ago, it feels kind of like December still this morning, rather than Easter. But on Christmas Eve, we read from the Gospel of Luke, when the shepherds saw the angels, they were scared to death. The King James says they were sore afraid. And the angel says, do not what? Don't be afraid. Do not be afraid. Do not be alarmed. We got good news for you. Or just like in the announcement of Jesus' birth, we have good news of great joy for all people. For to you is born in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. The angel here says similar. Do not be afraid. Jesus, he was crucified, yes. He had been placed here, yes. He was dead, yes. But he is not here any longer. But go. Tell his disciples and Peter that he's going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you. Why do you suppose the angel mentioned Peter by name? Why not all the other disciples? Why not? Why did the messenger of God say, tell his disciples, and Peter? In Isaiah chapter 43, well, I'll get to that. I'll read it here. But now, says the Lord, who created you, O Jacob, who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. This is a painting of Jesus, and Peter. And a woman and a rooster. There are several things going on in this painting. This is the night, Friday night, Good Friday, when Jesus is being handed over to Pilate. Peter's outside the courtyard, warming himself by the fire, and something just happened simultaneously. Can you see it? What is she doing? Pointing her finger, yeah. Who is she pointing her finger at? You were also one of his disciples. No, I was not. Sure you are. You sound just like him. You talk just the same. It's like when you're from North Convict, you're talking to talk like that, right? Sorry. Down in Bemidji, we don't talk like that at all. They can tell by his accent. We're from Galilee. That's up north. It's way up north. And he said it three times, and what happened? See it? What is that? There it was. And there's something else going on in this painting. Jesus is looking at him. See that? It's all going on at the same time. Pictures are 1,000 words. Luckily for you, I've used this, otherwise my sermon would be 10 times longer. Jesus is looking at Peter. Where's Peter looking? Is he looking at Jesus? No, he's not. Go tell the disciples. And Peter, the one who betrayed him. Three times. It's bad enough to do it once. He did it three times in a row. Go tell him. Tell the disciples. And Peter, he needed to hear it. Fear not, I've redeemed you. I've called you by name. You are mine. There we go. Added that over there. The response to the women is to run in terror, amazement, fear, and silence. Wait a minute. Fear and silence and terror, amazement. What? Is this any way to run a resurrection? What's going on, Mark? Why do you put that in there? Well, first, let it be said that the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, none of them provide an unambiguous, totally convincing account of the resurrection. Matthew tells us that some were worshiping Jesus, they see him alive, but others doubted as they were seeing Jesus. So even seeing isn't believing. Okay. Luke says, in their joy, they were disbelieving. John tells us that next week we're going to hear about this. One of the disciples wasn't there. His name was Thomas. And Thomas says, well, I don't believe you guys. Unless I see the nails and the marks of the nails and I see the scar on the side, and I want to stick my finger in those prints. I want to, in the wounds. Unless I do that, I'm not going to believe. What's going on? And of course, Mark, women ran away, afraid. Faith is not forced upon them. It's not coerced. They're not made to do it at gunpoint or sword point. Even on Easter. Mark does not use the appearance of Jesus in this Easter story. The others have Jesus showing up. That's one way of proving that he was alive. Now, two ways to prove it. St. Paul does this today. We read it. He appeared to Cephas, Peter. That's the name for Peter. Then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time. Most of them are still alive, so if you don't believe me, ask them. Some have died, yes. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. That's one way to do it. Just, you know, all these people saw him. He's alive. What Mark does is interesting. He expresses the faith of the promise of Jesus. Jesus said something to them. Descending from the Mount of Transfiguration, he told Peter, James, and John, don't tell anybody about this resurrection stuff. Each of the predictions, passion prediction, Jesus predicted his death three different times. He included, at the end, the promise of the resurrection. And on the way to Gethsemane, Jesus told them, after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee. Why Galilee? Well, that's where Jesus called five of the apostles. Peter, Andrew, James, John, and Matthew is on the seashore, taxing people. How many fish you got? Okay, 10% tax, you know, whatever. Why Galilee? Well, what do you do when you're scared? What do you do when you're afraid? Where do you end up? Where do you want to go? They go back home. That's where they live. It's a familiar place. But before they get there, Jesus promises something to them. There you will see him, just as he said. He is going to go ahead of you. Place they will see Jesus the risen Jesus, is back home, back in the ordinary stuff of life. The Gospel of John, it talks about us, what are we going to do? Well, let's go fishing. We might as well do something. And that's where Jesus said, I'm going to meet you there. Jesus is going to keep his promises, even to those who failed him, even to Peter, who has denied him. That is a message that Mark's readers needed to hear, and Mark's hearers need to still hear. We still need to hear this message. What do you say to a group of Christians about the resurrection of Christ? This is not only a question that faced Mark's Mark. What do I say to this group of people? But it faces preachers every Easter. What do you say to people that know the story? Well, when Mark wrote his Gospels, he knew that most of the people who were going to hear his scripture, or hear it read, not all people could read or write, but they would have someone read it out loud to them, read the letter in presence of people. Most of the people that were going to hear it didn't need to be convinced that Jesus was Lord and that he was alive and he was raised from the dead. They believed that already. They already knew it. It's called preaching to the choir, and Mark knew that. But Mark must be doing something different as well to include this unique ending. They were living under the reign of Nero. Nero was one of the greatest persecutors of Christians who ever lived. It was under his reign that both Peter and Paul were executed. And many of Mark's hearers, were facing the same possibility. Death by the Colosseum, tied up to a cross, burnt at the stake, as this is depicted here. Or, let the lions eat you, as you sang hymns, as was going on. Where is Jesus in the midst of this stuff? Well, what does Mark say? There he will see you, just as he said. He's going to go there ahead of you. In Galilee, and wherever else you may be, Jesus is going to be there with you. In the midst of their troubles, Jesus is there. No matter what the storms of life may bring. It might be death by persecution. It might just be the stuff of life. Life is hard. It's always been hard. And Jesus is there ahead of us. Perhaps some of them felt like utter failures trying to follow in the way of Jesus in their trials. And they need to be reminded, he's going ahead of you there. You're not alone in this. Just like he calms the storm then, he calms the storm now. Mark tells them, he goes ahead. Through trials, through sufferings, even through death. Even if they have failed Jesus, like Peter did, Jesus will not fail them. This also is a message that we need to hear. Not just in our own references to our own death, or suffering that we have, we'll see. What about what do we do tomorrow? What do we do this afternoon, later today? Well, some of us have an Easter dinner planned, and you're going to go home to, some of you will go at home, well, the house needs cleaning, car needs to be fixed, shopping needs to be doing, again, people coming over for dinner, praying that the pastor doesn't preach too long, that roast is going to be burnt to a crisp, right? It can be easy to see the risen Christ, you know, here this morning, the beautiful procession as the children and young people help provide the decorations and the flowers for our Easter, the great songs and singing. But what about afterwards? That's what Mark was giving us. What about tomorrow? What about the next day? You know, we heard trouble is coming. What's going to happen if trouble comes to our town? Or what if that plant shuts down? What if that job promotion doesn't happen? Or what if they pick someone else? You know, that's what Mark was getting at. Where is Jesus when we get back to normal. There he has gone ahead. He has gone there ahead of them. He also goes there ahead of us. There we will see him. Just as he said then. Just as it's true now. Thanks be to God. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Okay, please stand.